So it's a real pleasure to have Kristian Lum today as our colloquium speaker. I've been trying to arrange this for a very long time, and so has she, and I'm sure she'll visit us physically, hopefully in the coming year. Kristian is one of the leading figures in the study of fairness and accountability in algorithms in high-stakes decisions, including criminal justice. She's one of my main gurus on the subject and has written many of the papers that are key readings if you want to start learning about this, including on predictive policing and risk assessment. So she got her undergraduate degree in math and statistics from Rice and her PhD in statistical science at Duke. She's been for some time the lead statistician for the Human Rights Data Analysis Group and recently took a research professor position at Penn. And take it away. Thank you very much for being here.
No, thank you for having me. It's fantastic to kind of make it out to you all. I've been trying, like Chris said, for a couple years now, and circumstances got in the way a few times, and the latest circumstance to get in the way was COVID, which has gotten in the way of many things more than just my travel plans. So I'm really glad to be able to have the opportunity to talk to you all today, even though it's remotely. So like Chris said, a lot of the topics that I work on for the past several years have been fairness, accountability, and transparency. And the major topic area that I work on through the application area is criminal justice. And so as I was thinking back on my work over the last several years, what I plan to do is talk about three projects I've done over the last several years, one of them going back almost 5 years now. But I realized that in my work, I'd sort of hit on all of the main topic areas, the fairness, the accountability, and the transparency. I feel like I have a pretty good example of the importance of each of those now. And so I'm hoping to just give you all a little bit of an overview of the importance and where these sorts of headline topics come up in the criminal justice system when we're talking about predictive modeling. And I hope to convince you that each of these are very important aspects when dealing with predictive models in the criminal justice system. All right, so the first one, fairness. Like I said, I'm gonna hit all three, some of them more in depth than others. And the context in which I wanna talk about this today is predictive policing. So this comes from a project I did with William Isaac. I think it started back in 2015. And so predictive policing, what is that? Essentially, it's predictive models applied to police records. And those models can predict where crime will occur in the future, or in some cases, they're predicting, or at least trying to predict, who will commit crime in the future. Okay, so that's sort of just the big picture idea. You're gonna take police records, build some sort of predictive model from them, and then make projections to the future, either about places or people. And we see this in the news quite a bit, you know, all sorts of headlines about predictive policing, at least I do, in the sort of circles I run in the news sources I see a lot. And a lot of the words that comes up on this upper left-hand screen that I'd point to if I were in person is biased. Is it biased, right? And that word, I think, when we're talking about all these issues, needs a lot of unpacking, because what does that mean exactly? In this case, one of the types of bias I want to talk to you all about is sampling bias. And in this sense, what I want to talk to you about is when we're training models to police records, are those records themselves a representative sample of the crime that takes place in a city? And sort of the overarching theme of a lot of work that's come out of the fairness, accountability, and transparency work in machine learning has sort of said, like, okay, if the data is biased, whichever definition you're working with here, I'm talking about sampling bias or unrepresentative data, then that bias sort of gets propagated through the model. And so the question we really want to ask ourselves then are police records a representative sample of that data of crimes that occur in a city? And my take on this, and I think many people would agree with this, is that no, not necessarily, especially when we're talking about certain types of crimes. And so what are some reasons that police records themselves might not be a representative sample of crime? So one reason is variation in reporting rates. And you can see this in the National Crime Victimization Survey, which indicates that reporting rates vary substantially by demographic characteristics. So some crimes are more likely than others to be reported to the police depending on who was victimized. So one of the patterns I saw when I very briefly looked at that data was that older people were more likely to report crimes that occurred to them than younger people. And in this case, when we're talking about bias in the data, so again, the sampling bias, some crimes seem more likely to appear than other crimes, and this derives not from the police themselves, but from the community in some sense, right? So it's the community that's sort of differentially deciding to report. So Some other sources of non-representativeness or bias in the data is variation in police attention. So in this one, I'm just really talking about the idea that crimes that are committed in areas that are highly patrolled by police are more likely to be discovered by the police than those committed in less patrolled areas. And so in this one, I'm you know, kind of just appealing to common sense, in the sense I'm saying, look, you're going to find more things where you're looking for them than where you're not looking for them. And so when police go out, they don't have sort of like a sampling frame. They're not really trying to collect a simple random sample. And so there's not really any reason to believe that that would happen just by accident, right? That's something I like to keep in mind. Statistics spends a whole lot of time trying to figure out how to come up with representative samples. It doesn't just happen by accident. And so when there is this variation in police attention, even if it is the product of legitimate policing strategy, whatever that means, you know, that's not coming up with a representative sample necessarily. And the last one, which I think sort of dovetails most closely with what people think about when they hear the word bias, they hear it with the word policing, especially now, is variation in rates of arrest, even for similar criminal behavior. So in this case, one example of that is while white and black populations use marijuana at similar rates, blacks are arrested for marijuana possession at a rate several times that of whites. And I have a little link down at the bottom if you want to follow that up, but this is a fairly well cited statistic to sort of demonstrate that even if there is similar levels of criminal activity or legal activity, depending on where you are, I guess, these days, there still can be differential levels of enforcement or arrest for that same type of behavior. And so what I wanted to investigate how predictive policing worked in the wild, but unfortunately there weren't a whole lot of examples of predictive policing algorithms just out there where they'd say where they were deploying police based on the algorithms. But luckily one company, Predpol, some of the founders of that, published a paper in JASA, which is one of the main statistics journals, where they outlined the algorithm that they are using in a sort of field study of their use of their software to make predictions about the locations of future crimes. And so I was able to reproduce it, and I wanted to run it on real data. And time I was living in, I was still living in Durham, but my job was based in the Bay Area. And so we were thinking we wanted to do something Bay Area based. And so we ended up finding this data on openoakland.org, which is an organization based out of Oakland that makes city and government data from Oakland more accessible. They've done a lot of work to geotag all sorts of things. And so they had a data set on police records of crimes. So in this case, I'm looking at the police records of drug crimes in Oakland in 2010. And so I've made a heat map here. Brighter red means they had more records in some location, the brighter red locations, and the sort of pinker or more salmon-y areas, they had fewer records. There are a few sort of interesting artifacts in this data set. So that Piedmont area right there, that's actually just a neighborhood, not a lake, but there's some sort of weird administrative boundary issues going on with where jurisdictions weren't included. And so that ends up not counting in this data set. But in any case, this is what the drug crimes recorded by police looked like in Oakland in 2010. I combined this with some other data to think about, okay, well, how representative is this, right? Like what's going on here? And so I found some data on public health surveys of drug use. Keep in mind that in the figure on the left, many of those crime reports on drug crimes were simple possession. And so we thought, okay, let's just see where drug users likely live. So I combined high resolution census data with a public health survey on who uses drugs and came up with the map on the right. Now this is just an estimate. This sort of says, what are the locations that have demographics that look like people are using drugs? And we came up with something on the thing on the right that looks a lot more dispersed than the thing on the left. And one thing to notice about the thing on the right is this has a lot more to do with population density than really anything else, because people tend to use drugs at similar rates, according at least to the public health surveys that I was looking at. I think another really useful lens through which to look at the map on the left is this other figure on the right over here. So this shows just the demographics by race of Oakland. And this was done manually, just to be clear. So the circle and the line, I put both of those on there manually, but I zoomed in really close and tried to center around the same roads and everything. And so the circle on the right corresponds to the circle on the left, and the line on the right corresponds to the line on the left. And we can see I've sort of put those two indicators in the locations where we're seeing a lot of records of drug crime in the data set, right? We see this sort of one hot spot on the left in that circle, and then this sort of line over along the right. And what we see when we look at the map on the right, where each blue dot corresponds to one white person, each green dot corresponds to one black person, each red dot corresponds to one Asian person, and each orange dot to one Hispanic person, and I guess that brownish dot corresponds to anybody else, we see that the circle is really over a predominantly black neighborhood, and the line is really across a predominantly Hispanic neighborhood. So we can see that where these hotspots in policing are, or policing or recording of drug crimes are really occurring in essentially minority neighborhoods. This, again, despite the fact that people do tend to use drugs at similar rates, even when you break it down by race. All right. There we go. And so what we did, this is playing a movie now. I hope you can all see that. So what we did was we took the predictive policing algorithm that was published in JASA and applied it to this Oakland data set. And so how it works is it does a moving window approach. So you apply the algorithm, say, to January 1st of last year to December 31st of last year to make a prediction for January 1st. Then you slide that window one day ahead. So you do it from January 2nd of last year to January 1st of this year to make a prediction for January 2nd of this year. So you just use all the data up until yesterday and to a year ago before that, and then output a prediction for each day. And that's essentially based on the paper that I read, how they were doing it in practice when they were running their experiments using this sort of software. And so I did that. I used the data from 2010 and I made predictions for each day in 2011 going forward. So actually using data in 2011 too, because as that sliding window moves forward, you do have to use data in 2011 also. And what they did in the paper was they picked the top K sites, it was 20, and they labeled those for additional police attention. And so we did the same thing here, and I'm labeling each location that was one of the top 20 predicted by the model with a red square. And you can sort of watch the video for a second and see how the red squares move around. And the answer is that they don't move around a whole lot. So what we see is that the police get sent largely back to that circle area and only back to that line right across that line that I showed you that was in the largely Hispanic neighborhood if we were to do this exercise using drug crime data. And so I think maybe I didn't say it very explicitly when I was looking at those other models, those other maps, but I think what those maps were showing when we were looking at where the drug crime was being recorded, where relative to where I think it's probably happening, which is everywhere, is that there are places that were really sort of over-policed with respect to drug crime. There are places where the police were really recording as a proportion more drug crimes in those particular locations than were representative. And we see that the algorithm ends up essentially reproducing that same behavior, but in a way that's sort of predictive and now telling people they should go back. So in the past, we've had this sort of historical bias or this sort of historical over-policing that causes this sort of non-representativity in the data. But then when that gets passed through an algorithm, the algorithm now says, now you just need to keep going back to those same neighborhoods. If we look at the figure on the right, this shows the percent of the population receiving targeted policing under this model. So we used again that high resolution census data and looked at what percent of the population was within each of those red squares at each time, averaged over all the time points. We found that the black population was receiving targeted policing at a rate that was about twice that of the white population when we ran this algorithm. And this is again compared to the figure on the bottom, which is percent using drugs according to public health surveys and adjusted for the demographics of Oakland. And so we again see this sort of disparity and how the algorithm could potentially perpetuate the sorts of bias that we've seen in the past. But you know, all of these that video I just showed you and everything before that was sort of assuming when I was doing it that when the police went to those locations, so as I moved that sliding window forward and did the and reran the model and made the prediction, I just left the data as it was in the past. I didn't actually assume that when the police went to those red squares, they would have found anything different than they actually did, right? So I was just sort of sticking very closely to the data. But there is sort of a question that we can address with simulation now, sort of deviating from the data exactly as it is, sort of asking this counterfactual scenario. Okay, so what if when we sent police to those red squares, they find a little bit more crime than they would have anyway? When we're talking about things like drug crimes, I think it's reasonable to believe that the harder you look, the more you're going to find. And so how would that play out in this case? And so I think this seems to run. There we go. And so we did the same thing again here. And this time, in this simulated data now, each time the police went to one of those red squares, we simulated an extra 20% above and beyond what they found there initially. So we just said, okay, on average, about 20, you're gonna find about 20% more crime than you did originally. And we wanted to see how that played out. We made up the 20%. I have no idea how much more they would find, by the way, but that was just sort of, this is kind of a thought experiment in some sense, or sort of a simulation example. And it's sort of hard to see in the figure, but one, if you, you know, calculate some statistics on this, the red squares move around a lot less in this example, but we could really see what's going on the right here. So the baseline in the, these are smooth lines, by the way, this gray line, this baseline is just what happened in the original scenario where we're showing the predicted odds of crime in the targeted locations versus the non-targeted location. So how many times more likely does this model think crime is going to be occurring in the red squares than outside of the red squares? So when we did the original one where we just left the data as is, we get this gray line. So the model's pretty flat across time. It doesn't think there's a whole lot changing. It thinks there's about 25 times more crime in the targeted squares than the non-targeted squares. And that remains fairly flat. And I wouldn't say those are meaningful differences across time, even though it goes up a little bit because the smoother, I didn't put a whole lot of effort into doing any sort of statistics or hypothesis testing on that. But when we add the 20%, we get the black line here. So we end up going from something like, I don't know, the model thinks there's about 20 times more drug crime in the red squares than elsewhere, up to thinking there's about 65 more times. So we end up with this feedback loop where police in this simulated world go to these locations, essentially going back a step, because of historical over-policing in these certain locations, the model sends them back to those locations. They go back to those locations, they find a little bit more crime, that crime gets fed back into the model, and sort of the model becomes more sure and more sure and more sure that these are the right places they need to be going, sort of perpetuating, and in this case, amplifying the concentration of policing for these sorts of crimes in those particular locations. All right, so what
Hey, Kristian, there was a question in the chat about what types of drug crimes these are. You mentioned that it included possession, but does it also include more serious drug-related crimes in the data?
It does. It does. I don't, you know, this was from several years ago. I don't remember the exact breakdown, but possession was a large proportion. I think it was something like 80% of them, but there were other things as well. But don't quote me on that number. I'd have to go back and look at the data again. But it was a significant enough proportion that I felt like even doing that comparison to who's using drugs is probably a fair thing to do. It wasn't by and large people selling drugs. It wasn't by and large like drug kingpins or something. It seemed like it was, that's not what was going on in the data, but that's an excellent question.
And just a note to everybody, so I'm following the chat, Kristian is not. If there's a burning question, you should feel free to unmute yourself and go ahead and ask it if you don't want to wait to the end.
Yeah, please feel free to do that. I literally cannot see the chat the way that this slideshow is set up. So you're also free to put it in the chat and Chris can interrupt if it's really important, but you know, everyone should also feel free to hop in when they'd like to. All right, so what does this have to do with fairness? So I said I was gonna cover the three big topics. This is fairness. And I think the big takeaways for this for me were that one, the model that was running in this case, this predictive policing model, only includes information like the times and locations of the past crimes. It doesn't really include anything else. And in fact, that's one of the selling points of this model. It's marketed as being race neutral, largely because it's just the times and locations of recorded crimes. And so this model does not explicitly incorporate anything like race or demographic information in whatever block that it's predicting, right? So even models that omit sensitive variables like race are not neutral. You can end up perpetuating the sort of harmful bias even without explicitly incorporating something like this, like the demographic breakdown of each block within the area that's being predicted. And I think the other takeaway I have from this sort of work is that explicit attention to fairness has to be paid if we want to avoid perpetuating historical bias via a predictive model. So we have to really think very carefully about where the data is coming from, what the sort of generative process of that data is. Is that data itself being generated by a process that you could say is unfair? And do we want to perpetuate the sort of correlations and the relationships that exist in that data into the future? Like what, you know, we have to be very sort of thoughtful and intentional about those sorts of things, especially when we're dealing with data that, or models that have such high stakes and high impact on the world, on the lives of people who are sort of being policed in this case, or in any area where these are affecting high impact decisions. All right, so now I want to move on to accountability. Can someone also let me know if I'm going way under or way over, because I also can't see the clock with this whole setup. But if I'm just gonna assume I'm doing reasonably on time unless someone tells me otherwise. Okay, so the next one I wanna talk about is a second project. And this one I hope to talk to you a little bit about the importance of accountability when we're talking about the use of predictive models in the criminal justice system. And this is a project that just came out early this year, officially. And this project was done with my colleague at HRDeg, Megan Price, and Chase Aboudin, who is now the District Attorney of San Francisco. But when I started this project many years ago with him, he was a public defender. So that ended up being a very exciting turn of events for this project. And the context in which I want to talk about the importance of accountability is this look at overbooking and its effect on risk assessment. So I need to define a couple of things before I can go forward. So one, overbooking, and two, risk assessments. Okay, so overbooking, this one's actually fairly simple, and conceptually at least it's simple. So just booking a person who's been arrested on charges that are higher and more serious than warranted. So when a person is arrested, the arresting officer will take them to the jail. This study takes place in San Francisco, so I'm giving you sort of the cartoon version of what happens there, but I believe it's fairly similar from location to location. And there, the arresting officer has to report sort of the legal basis for that person's detention. What are they claiming the person did, right? What are the sort of legal codes that describe this person's behavior that justify their arrest and why they're being detained? So then through the criminal legal process, that can be things like plea deals, that can be anything, that can also be things like trials. The former happens a lot more than the latter, just taking guilty pleas to charges. What we get at the end of that are conviction charges. So what the person was actually convicted of in the end. And so on the one hand, sort of conceptually saying booking someone on charges that are like unwarranted or too high is a really simple thing to think about, you know, when we think about, oh yeah, just adding on some extra charges or something, but how do you actually measure that becomes really complicated. And so what we decided to do in this case is, I really like bad transitions, by the way, sorry, I'm a child of the 90s, I can't help it, learned PowerPoint in middle school and never left me. So, you know, we said, okay, to actually operationalize what we mean by overbooking, we're going to say charges were overbooked if they didn't actually lead to a conviction. So we're going to compare the conviction charges to the booking charges, and any charges that were sort of dropped along the way, we're going to say, okay, there wasn't really those were unsubstantiated by the criminal legal process, and we're going to say those were essentially overbooked. And you could argue with that decision, and I think it's fair to argue with that decision. High booking charges themselves can cause higher conviction charges. So if really scary and serious charges are tacked on at the beginning, that can lead to the conditions where people will take pleas for more of those charges to sort of get some of the highest ones dropped off, for example. And I think it goes the other way too, right? It seems maybe a little bit disingenuous to say that charges were unsubstantiated or it was due to overbooking if, say, the person actually did commit the behavior that's described by the particular code, and then their defense attorney is just like barely able to establish reasonable doubt, something like that, right? It goes both ways. I think by and large, the larger effect is the former, that the conviction charges, the comparison between conviction charges and booking charges probably understates the degree of overbooking, but that's, you know, another story for another day. And also when we actually want to deal with data, we have to make some of these fairly arbitrary decisions. And this seems like a reasonable one to make. We're going to say the gold standard is what the criminal legal system in the end actually determined, you know, the person is guilty of. So that's how we define overbooking in this case. The other thing I need to tell you about is pretrial risk assessment or risk assessment in general. Again, like when I was talking about the predictive policing, I'm not going into any kind of, real level of detail about the modeling. I know you all are math people and I totally could, but I'm trying to keep this fairly high level. So I think we can just think about these things as models that take some sort of input data, feed it into the risk assessment model, and out the other side either comes a prediction or some sort of recommendation. So when that person is arrested and they're being detained, a decision has to be made about what's going to happen to that person. Should they be released? Should they be released with some sort of conditions, like maybe they need to check in, call in a couple times a week, something like that. And that's what this recommendation is at the other end of this model. It's saying, okay, this is what we think the appropriate conditions of release or not releasing at all are for this person who's been arrested. So typically, the sorts of inputs to this type of model are the person's criminal history, number of prior arrests, maybe number of prior arrests in the last couple of years, demographic information, things like their age, sometimes gender, and those booking charges that I just talked about, at least in some of the models. And I'm going to break down what's under this other one in just a second. Come on. There we go. And it gets really complicated. So I want to sort of talk about a particular pretrial risk assessment model, which is really popular, which is called the public safety assessment. It's Arnold Venture's tool, PSA. It's called a lot if you've been following this. And so it looks a lot like what I just talked to you about. It has a few different pieces. So there's the criminal history and demographic information are the inputs to two different models. So one of them is a failure to appear risk model, that's FTA. And the other one is a rearrest risk model. So these are essentially based on statistical models that take those two sets of covariates, criminal history, demographic information. Somewhere along the line, somebody fit some sort of statistical models, and that they come up with a risk model where they're predicting either whether the person will fail to appear for their court dates if they're released, or whether they will be rearrested. So there's two separate models. One predicts their failure to appear, and one predicts their rearrest. You can see what those look like here. I took these from the Arnold PSA's information portal. So if we look at the failure to appear one, we can sort of see what goes into it. So if there's a pending charge at the time of arrest, they get, if it's yes, they get 1 point. If it's no, they get 0 points. Prior failure to appear older than 2 years, yes, 1 point, zero, no points. Then you add up all those points. You translate to the scaled score and you get a number between 1 and 6. And that's essentially your FTA risk score. Similarly, on the right, they have something like age at current offense. You can see different age levels get different numbers of points, number of prior convictions, et cetera. Again, you add up all these points. You can actually do this on your fingers if you want. That's the sort of advantage of having these not be, of having the points be integers rather than something that you would typically see when you fit statistical models. And then you rescale those and you again get a value between 1 and 6. So you end up with, you're a 1 to 6 on your risk of failure to appear, and you're a 1 to 6 on your risk of being rearrested according to these models. So that's one component of this. So those then end up being combined. So you can see this second blue arrow here. This is really a diagram that requires pointing, but remotely that's difficult, to get you an initial recommendation. Okay, so if you're a, say, 1 on FTA and a 2 on NCA, so that's a 1 on a failure to appear and 2 on rearrest, you're in the green, which is the lowest level of supervision. That's just let you go. If you're, say, a 5 on FTA and a 5 on rearrest, that's, or NCA at the top, they say release not recommended. They recommend that the person not be released, et cetera. So you end up, you see there's these four different levels, green, yellow, orange, red. Green is the most lenient, just let the person go. Red is do not let them go. Yellow and orange are somewhere in the middle with things like calling in, checking in, different levels of supervision that fall between those two extremes. Okay, so let's go back to this model. You don't have to remember all the details of this, but I just want to give you a sense of how these things are actually calculated, because risk assessment in general has become a really interesting topic right now around its relationship with bias and pretrial reform. And I think understanding sort of the complexity of some of these models is a little bit useful, but don't worry, you don't have to remember all of these details. So there's a third model called the violence risk model, which takes the criminal history, demographic information, and those booking charges. So that's the important thing here. And then puts out a 0 or a 1, a yes or no, do we think this person is at risk of being rearrested for a violent offense. And there's another step, which is exclusions and bump up. So this takes that initial recommendation, it takes that violence score, and it again takes those booking charges that go into this second, I wouldn't exactly call it a model. So the exclusions look something like this. It's essentially a really, really complicated decision tree. So if the booking charges contain any of the following charges or any of the following behaviors on the left, then we automatically exclude them. So even if they were a 1 and a 1, their initial recommendation is just let them go. If their booking charge is any of the things on the left, well, we're automatically gonna say we shouldn't let them go at all. Or based on this column on the right, if the booking charge contains a violent charge, or the list of violent charges, I think was something like 400 charges, and that violence flag is 1, so the violence flag is also a function of the booking charges, then also just absolutely do not let them go. there are also bump ups that can happen based on the booking charges. So if the booking charge contains any of these other charges here, all of these seem very serious, then we increase by one. So if you're green, you go to yellow. If you're yellow, you go to orange. If you're orange, you go to red. And then again, there's this other decision you have to make. If the booking charges do not contain the violent charge and the violence flag is one, then you still do that bump up. So again, this is just to give a sense of the complexity of what's going on here. And I think what's important to realize here is that one, this first set of models on the left, these are based on statistical models. These are based on empirical correlations in the data. Like that's how those were built. And so in some sense, even if the charges are overbooked, all of the issues with bias in the data aside, at that level, maybe they do correlate with bad outcomes that you're concerned about. So maybe that's less worrisome. But these exclusions and bump ups are in fact not based on any sort of empirical correlations or statistical models. These are based on politics. And as I understand it, when one of these things is implemented, essentially people, different stakeholders get together and negotiate about which charges should appear on which lists. And this will vary from jurisdiction to jurisdiction. And this is out of necessity, right? Like the penal codes differ from jurisdiction when we're talking about different states. And so to some extent, you can't just say, we'll take the penal codes from California and apply them to Oklahoma because they're not the same. So that you do have to make some decisions there, but it is, as I come to understand it from speaking to people who've been involved, a fairly political process. And at the other end of that, again, you get that pretrial recommendation. So all this stuff in the middle I just talked about was just that gray box, that that pretrial risk assessment tool, essentially a very complicated decision tree. Okay, which is combining sort of political decisions with statistical models in a way that's not entirely obvious until you really dig down into the weeds. So what's the plan here? Since we want to understand the role that overbooking plays in influencing this risk assessment model, we're gonna run the risk assessment model using those booking charges. This is how it's actually done. So you take the person's inputs, their criminal history, their demographic information, and their booking charges, you run it through the risk assessment model, and you get the recommendation what the model says should happen to that person after they've been arrested. Then we're going to wait a couple years, which like literally is what we did. We had to wait a couple years to see what happened with all these cases. And we're going to rerun the model again, where instead of plugging in the booking charges, we're going to plug in only those conviction charges. So essentially say, what would the model have said if we could have known at the time what the appropriate charges were? And then we're going to compare those two things. We're going to say that the risk assessment model was influenced by overbooking if the recommendation under the booking charges is higher than it was under the charges that the person was convicted of. And I don't know how closely you all were looking at these lists, but when you look at these lists, when I at least first came to this, I wasn't especially thinking that this was going to be a huge effect, because you look at the sorts of things we're talking about that get you bumped up all the way, or that sort of really how the booking charges really enter into this model, it's really pretty serious charges, things like murder, carjacking, things like that. And so, how often does that happen that you people get booked under those sorts of things and then it doesn't actually lead to conviction? That's sort of the question here. Okay, so the data we used was data from a pilot run of the PSA. So that's the particular risk assessment model we're looking at. And we had about 2,000 cases that were processed during this pilot study. We got PDFs of all of those. And initially we entered them by hand, and then we ended up building something to scrape them, which was a much better plan. And in this data, we have individuals' name and unique ID, their arrest date, and the charges they were booked under. We combine this data with court records. So we got all charges for anyone who touched the criminal justice system in San Francisco during the period under the study, about 70,000 charges. And in that data set, we also had individuals' names and unique IDs, their arrest date, a court number, and an outcome for every charge, so whether they are found guilty or not guilty. And so we were able to link these two data sets based on the person's name/unique ID and their arrest date to figure out what actually happened to all those charges that went into the model initially. And so the first thing we wanted to do was just make sure that we are accurately representing what that complicated decision tree sort of model was doing. And so we wanted to make sure that everything we were calculating matched up in the data when we ran it with the booking charges. We said, okay, if we plug the booking charges and all the inputs in, do we pretty much get the same thing as what they got initially, since that's how they were doing it? And the answer is yes. Across pretty much all the things we looked at, the NVCA flag, the exclusions, the bump ups, we got agreement on whether those things should occur over 99% of the time, and the recommendation was a little bit lower. For every case where there's a disagreement, we actually went in and looked and made a judgment call on why we thought there was an agreement, and if we thought there was a problem, we went and updated the code to make sure that it addressed everything. So what sort of discrepancies did we find that we were like, yeah, we're okay with these differences remaining. We think our code is accurately reflecting the model, reflecting what's done in practice. In some cases, different charges were listed in the court database than listed in the PSA. I don't know how that could happen. I mean, in some cases, it almost seemed like a typo, like either the PSA was run with a typo or the person who entered in the court database had a typo on what the exact charge was. But in any case, that's something that we don't have a lot of control over. There's also some inconsistency in interpreting some of the rules. So sometimes there's one in one of those bump ups, I believe it's the bump up, if it involves the quote use of a firearm, it's supposed to give you a bump up or the exclusion. And in some cases, wielding a replica firearm counted for that. In some cases, it didn't. There are all sorts of these little tiny things we're kind of like, yeah, I mean, that's just how this goes. Okay. And so what were our results here? So we looked at what percent of people got exclusions, bump ups, the violence flag, that's NVCA, and the average recommendation using only the conviction charges. And we found, you can see the numbers there, about 8.7% of the time people got exclusions using the conviction charges relative to about 29% of the time using the booking charges, for a difference about 20.7%. Similarly, you can look over on the right, you can look at all of these. I mean, it's clearly higher. I mean, the direction in which the charges are, there's no question the charges are sort of overstating the extent of the criminal behavior relative to the conviction charges, which I think comes as no surprise to people who work in this area. But what I was surprised by was how often there were charges that were serious enough to cause an exclusion or to cause the model to sort of issue one of these policy-based overrides of the person that there wasn't sort of substantial evidence to convict the person of. So the recommendation was on average half a level higher using the the booking charges than the conviction charges. The table on the bottom just shows what percent of cases was the PSA under the booking charges higher than under the conviction charges. This looks very similar to the table above. But I think this is probably, at least for me, this is the more striking or maybe more relevant way to calculate it. So 20.9% of cases we looked at experienced an exclusion. So that's an automatic do not release based on charges the person is not ultimately convicted of. And 27.4% of the cases we looked at received a higher recommendation based only on charges that the person was not ultimately convicted of.
Kristian, just a question from the chat. What percentage of these were actually court trials and what percentage were plea bargains? I know that the former is a minority, but can you give us a sense?
I don't know, actually. So they were differentiated in the data. There are different disposition codes for those things. I combined them early on and I don't recall. I do recall my colleague Chasa saying that in San Francisco, they do go to trial more often than they do in other places, but I unfortunately don't know the answer to that question off the top of my head. I'd have to go look it up. Okay. And so I think, you know, an important lens through which to look at all of this is disaggregating results by race, because I think, you know, especially now, but even prior to now, I think one of the big concerns is racial bias and racial disparities in the criminal justice system. And so what I wanted to do was calculate all those things we just saw, but broken down by race. But first I wanna go on a little detour and talk about, if you'll allow me, if I have a few minutes to do this, to talk about the recording of race in the data. And so in the data that we had, which came from the court records, there was a race designation for each arrest, actually for each court record. And they have these different designations, B, C, H, O, U, and W. And so what I wanted to look at was how consistent these were. So my understanding was that these were the sort of perception of the person who entered the data rather than the person's own perception of their race, which in this case maybe is the relevant thing if we're concerned about discrimination. But I really wanted to understand how consistent those designations were. So in this table, we see it's a little bit hard to explain. So the B says for every individual who was listed as B on at least one of their arrests, what percent of all of their arrests were listed as B. So if there was perfect agreement, this would be 100. And the same for C. So that'd be the top, that'd be that 98.4. The sort of 1-2 element of this matrix is for every single person who was listed as B in at least one of their records, what percent of their records was listed as C? That would be 0.1, et cetera, going down. So if we go down to W here, for everybody who's listed as W at least once, what percent of the records were they listed as B? That'd be 0.4. So hopefully that makes sense. So we can see if it's perfect, if there's perfect agreement, you'd have 100 down the diagonal. And I should mention that these numbers don't actually sum to 100 across the rows, which they should, because I didn't include the missing data that's calculated separately. But and there were some other categories that were really, really rare that I dropped. But in any case, what we see, I really wish I had highlighted this, but what we can see is that really the only category that is really pretty consistently defined in this case is B, which I believe is Black. We actually didn't get a key, so I don't know what these different different designations are meant to mean, but I'm fairly certain that B is Black and W is white, based on my own sort of perceptions of how names and surnames map to racial identity. So again, based only on my own sort of ideas about what those things look like, I think C was sometimes used for like Chinese, although it did encompass pretty much anybody with an Asian last name. And there was an I, which I left off because it was fairly rare, which I believe conflated Native Americans and people from India. There are a whole host of issues with how race is recorded in this data. And I felt that the only really consistent one was B versus non-B. So, and I'm assuming it's Black versus non-Black. And so when I sort of disaggregate these results by race, that's really the only one I was comfortable doing, since like it seems like in all the other cases they weren't even sure how to classify people, and that was the only one that was consistent. So I just wanted to put that in, since obviously there are more groups than Black and non-Black, but that was a feature of the data that I thought was relevant to this analysis.
So you asked for a time check. We're just coming up to 1 o'clock. So do you think you can wrap up in another 10 minutes or so?
Absolutely. Okay. Thank you. So we looked at the results by race, and essentially what we found was, I think we'll just go to the bottom table then. So for black people were more likely to have an exclusion based on unsubstantiated charges than a white person. So an automatic do not release recommendation. They were very slightly about the same, more likely to get a bump up. They're more likely to get that violence flag triggered based only on charges that were ultimately unsubstantiated, but the recommendations were not that different, which seems sort of confusing. So they weren't really more likely to get an elevated recommendation based on unsubstantiated charges in the end. So why was that? When we look at the distribution of the recommendations based on for the initial recommendation before you apply the bump ups and the exclusions, what we see is that the distributions are not the same by group. So the Black individuals, the data set, were more likely to be in the highest level already, or the second highest level already. And so what this means was, even if they did have an unsubstantiated exclusion charge, that didn't ultimately change the recommendation because they're already in the highest group anyway. Does that make sense? So how that kind of plays out. So we end up finding that at each of these stages, they were more likely to have these really serious charges tacked on that were unsubstantiated. But ultimately, because the risks distribution was already skewed in this way that they were already in the higher groups, it didn't actually make a large difference in terms of the recommendations. All right, so what does this have to do with accountability? I think the use of these unvetted charges in the model opens the door for gaming the system, and that's something I really worry about with models that use booking charges. So in situations where there's wiggle room about what the appropriate charge is, one could elect the higher charge to induce a higher recommended level of supervision. You could imagine a situation where this is maybe a person who's known to police, and they, you know, really would like to keep this person off the street. It seems like there's not a whole lot of oversight or accountability or even feedback about how often the charges are sticking versus not sticking, or how appropriate the charges are. And that could be one fairly easy way to have something that seems objective, this model, issue a recommendation for not releasing the individual. And the judges might perceive that to be that it's because this person is risky, when it very well might be because additional charges were tacked on. I think one important step to take to combat that would be for monitoring the ratio of higher to lower charges for similar behaviors, that would obviously require a whole lot of contextual subject area knowledge about which are sort of the ones you could wiggle between. Another potential remedy would be to have a defendant advocate involved earlier in the process to contest poorly supported charges before they're used as inputs. Another, I think, potentially interesting future line here would be to disaggregate the effect of overbooking by booking officer to see if there are certain individuals who are overbooking at a much higher rate than others. And sort of at a bigger picture, I think this points to the fragility of these sorts of models under discretionary inputs like these. And I'm going to go, this is good that I'm running out of time because this is the last section. This is the shortest section. So this is on transparency. This is the section I'm calling model development coefficient estimation by committee. And this is a project I looked at to sort of look for racial disparities in predictive accuracy or predictive performance. So this is one of these sort of fairness looks at a risk assessment tool that's used in New York City. So it again, it's used data from New York City, 2009-2011. The outcome it was predicting was felony rearrest. It used features similar to what I talked about, past warrants, age, drug convictions, felony convictions. I won't read the rest of them off. You can see the sort of standard things that went into it. And the procedure they used was to fit a logistic regression, then find the smallest significant coefficients, the smallest in magnitude significant coefficient. So take all of the coefficients that come up with a p-value of less than 0.05, find the one that's smallest in magnitude, and then divide all the other coefficients by the smallest one and round the coefficients to the nearest integers. That's how they came up with those point values, like when you saw you get 1 point for being slightly young, 2 points for being very young, et cetera, right? So that's how they come up with these sort of, in this case anyway, integer point values. And to be clear, I don't know that that's what they did in the Arnold model, but this is a different risk assessment model that's using this procedure, which I think is fairly common. And so what they did was they applied that procedure I just said, the fitting the logistic regression, dividing by something small, and rounding to three different versions of the data set. So they had analytic data, what they called, this is randomly selected half of the data. So this is what I would think of as training data. Then they had validation data, which was the other half of the data, maybe something like test data. And then they had all of the data. So they had kind of three different data sets, but one of them's the union of the first two. So they applied that procedure and came up with three different models here. So the first one is the model they came up with using the analytic or analysis data, the second one is the validation data, and the third one is, the third column there, is what they got when they ran on the total data. And you can see that the numbers tend to be kind of different in a few cases. And so how they came up with the final point values to be used in practice, well, that's a mystery. And that seems to be lost to history, even having spoken to the folks who made this. What we think happened was they got back together with the city of New York, or at least is what I think, and then the city of New York gave feedback on which point values they liked the best. So in the first case, for it being 16 to 19, they thought, okay, well, maybe they thought two of them were six, that's better than nine. For age 20 to 29, it seems like, well, I guess 1 point's better than zero. For age 40 and older, the options, I guess, were -3 and -5. And maybe the idea was, take the average of a -3 and a -5 to come up with -4. And sort of so on down the line. Now you'll notice that most of the point values are consistent with the middle column, with the exception of a couple of times. But I think for anyone who is used to doing statistical modeling, this is somewhat of a bizarre pipeline, I think. For models, risk assessment models are usually touted as being a more objective way of making decisions when these sort of decisions behind the scenes end up getting made in ways that are entirely ad hoc, as far as I can tell. And so I'll be really quick. One of the questions I wanted to ask was, like, who did this hand selection benefit? So I looked at the difference between the actual score and the total score. So actual score is like what they decided the person, you know, after they'd done all that sort of hand picking of point values, what the person's score actually is in the model that gets applied to them to determine whether they're eligible for a program to be let out of jail. And the total score, which is what I think they meant to do, what I suspect they were doing when this started, was they're going to fit it to the analysis data set, validate on the validation, and then like for some sort of variable selection thing, and maybe just take the final points by fitting to that final total data set in the end. That's what I suspected. So I said, okay, I'll compare their score after we've done all the hand selecting to what their score would have been if we'd used that procedure only on the total data set. And so this just shows the difference between those two. And so what we see with lower values, being the person was better off and higher values being the person was worse off. So we see that by and large who benefited was younger people, Black people, and male people. And so that maybe makes sense in light of the fact that the data itself was taken from the height of stop and frisk, right? Maybe this was some kind of way of trying to sort of, in an ad hoc way, do some sort of correction. Maybe, you know, maybe the idea was these people have been over policed and over arrested, and so we should do something about it. But I think this really does speak to the need for transparency in these models when these models are actually being used to determine who's eligible to be released from jail. I think, you know, whether you agree with that decision or not, and whether you agree with the idea that those people should have maybe gotten more of a break than the model said, or whatever, right? I think it's fairly clear that that could have gone in a very different direction, and without some kind of transparency or oversight into that process, I find it hard to swallow the claim that these are entirely objective when this is sort of the process that can be used to create them. And so I'll end there since I know I'm really out of time. And I won't even say that. I think I've made all my points. So I'll just take some questions now. And here are all my colleagues and collaborators who worked on this with me.
Hey, thank you very much. So we don't really have a good applause convention yet on Zoom. But we certainly have time for some questions. So anyone who would like to unmute themselves and ask a question, including, if you wish, those who put a question in the chat before that we didn't respond to. I mean, I'm happy to start. I mean, I think this last piece of work is really interesting because, you know, the Arnold PSA, at least the parts of it that are actual statistics and not all these local jurisdictional bump ups and exclusions and so on, you described, but kind of the initial part, I think it's generally regarded as the most benign of these tools because at least as an artifact, it is transparent in the sense that, you know, I can explain to you why you got the score you did based on information in your criminal record. On the other hand, it's not transparent in terms of why are these factors the input factors? Why are these weights the weights they are? Where did the training data come from? And so on.
Right.
There's transparency kind of, as you say, in the pipeline, there could be a desire for transparency in the construction of it, which I think that's an interesting question, which is often left out.
Yeah, no, that's a really good point. I think you're absolutely right that transparency is usually talked about in the sense that you're discussing, like, can the person see the point values that are used to calculate their score so they know why they got that final score, but sort of broadening the question of why, right, to like, well, why is that the right point value, I think has largely not been the question that's being discussed in this area. And I think that that is obviously important when, you know, it very well could be essentially coefficient estimation by committee.
Right. Sonia? And by the way, I'm not sure if you all need me to call on you, but go ahead, Sonia.
Hello, thank you. That was a fantastic talk. I'm a law professor at the University of New Mexico School of Law, and this is exactly in my space of research. So by the end of August, I'm more than excited to talk with you. In particular, you really raised something that really caught my attention that I almost feel bad for not kind of really thinking. And you had put up on one of the slides about rioting and assault on a public official. Mm-hmm. And that really struck me because I feel poorly now that I had not realized that various or false arrest have this kind of play into any calculations, right? That mm-hmm. And the idea that Officer John Smith has a particular practice, who's actually going back and auditing to clean up some of those data points. So thank you for including that. I wanted to share something that we've also been studying here in New Mexico has been the lack of racial data in the system and the complication of street race versus a person's preferred or how they racially identify. Do you see any kind of way to reconcile that or to think about those that idea?
No, I mean, I think there certainly can be differences between those two things, right? And I think if we want to understand how racial disparities are playing out in the criminal justice system, we absolutely do have to be collecting that data. And I think both are relevant. I think from the point of view of like of analyzing whether someone's being discriminated against based on race or ethnicity, it probably is relevant to know how they're perceived by the person who's arresting them or the person who's entering the data. But I think it's also relevant to know how they perceive themselves. And I'm not aware of any data sets in this area that look at both. I was talking to this one sociology graduate student, and I haven't looked into this very deeply, but who suggested that more contact with the criminal justice system can actually change how the person is perceived. So if they have like a longer criminal history, they might be more likely to be listed as Black, for example. I don't know if that's true. I haven't looked at it in this data. I don't actually think I have sufficient data. I don't think I have like a long enough time series to really look at how that changes over time. But I think that could also be another really interesting question.
More questions?
This is Anjali. I have a question both about your first two, something related to both of your first two parts of the talk. So in the first part, you had simulated what would happen if there's more intense policing or sort of looking for arrests more likely. Mm-hmm. And you had estimated that as 20%, just sort of saying like, well, what would happen if things are more intensely looked at? And then in the second part of the talk, you were talking about these risk assessment models for booking. I'm wondering if we should think about these models and algorithmic tools as being compounding or additive on beyond existing human biases of police officers and law enforcement in general, which seems to be the case when you're thinking about assuming like a 20% increase in arrests just because they're looking more carefully. Mm-hmm. And if so, what data do we have on whether there's sort of these human biases in addition to the algorithm simply replacing human biases?
Yeah, you make a really great point. And I think, you know, in some ways disaggregating, sort of my work has really only looked at each of these different touch points, maybe isn't the right word, but you know, these different points in the criminal justice or criminal legal process where algorithms are used in isolation. But I think you're absolutely right that there can be interaction effects as they go through, and I'd be really interested to learn more. I know I have spoken to some people who are interested in taking on this question of how, you know, not just the feedback loop within the one single algorithm, the one I showed in the beginning where you go look for more crimes, you find more crimes, and that goes in, but sort of how this all feeds through the pipeline, like how that feeds into risk assessments, how that then feeds into other risk assessments. So even once somebody is in jail or prison, I think there are a variety of risk assessments that are used. Obviously, this varies depending on jurisdiction, but in some cases, there are ones that are used to determine like what services are available for those people. And then there are ones used at sentencing and one used for parole and all these sorts of things, and how those all sort of compound, I think is a really, really fascinating question. And honestly, I don't know. I mean, it's frankly really hard to get data, at least it has been for me so far. I've had to do a lot of my time has been spent trying to get data, and I'm not aware of any data set that follows all of this from start to finish. That almost sounds like something where like a simulation with reasonable assumptions would be something really useful, where each component is itself sort of fit to data, but then sort of cobbling them together in some way that makes sense would probably be, that's probably where I would start thinking about it. But honestly, I don't know. That's a great question.
Thank you.
More questions?
I have one. Hi, thanks a lot for the presentation. I thought it was super interesting. And I had a question about the data that was collected and used for your project. I was wondering if you know how this data is collected, like when someone has committed a crime or is in jail, who is kind of filling out those slots, who's answering those questions, and are people whose questions are being answered about aware that this kind of data is being collected?
I think typically, yes. And I mean, so again, it's hard to speak in complete generality about all different risk assessments across all time and space because there's differences. But in a lot of places, there's what's called like a pretrial department where they'll do like a pretrial interview. And so they'll take this kind of information. And so I think, yes, typically the person is aware that the information is being collected. I can't say that's always the case, certainly. I can't say that it's necessarily the case the person knows what the information is being collected for across all time and space and context, but at least in the pretrial context, I think there's usually some sort of interview that happens. So they're giving that data within jails and prisons. I'm actually not sure. They might not even know. And I think at least anecdotally, I've heard in some cases that people aren't aware the extent to which their data is used to sort of use these models to classify them. I like the thumbs up. That's good.
I'm going to abuse my position as moderator and ask another question. So in a lot of the data sets that I'm aware of, new criminal activity, AKA rearrest, is one bit. And similarly, failure to appear is one bit. I have a collaborator at UNM who has been looking locally at the Arnold PSA, and they've been collecting like what the charge was within certain categories to see if it was major or minor and compare it to the original charge. Mm-hmm. But my impression is that there's very little when we both train and these tools and assess them for accuracy, that except for my colleague at UNM, I have the impression that they're all based on this one bit definition of failure to appear and new criminal activity. Is that true, or are there better data sets out there to your knowledge?
Well, I think, it depends, right? When we're talking about the data itself, the data sets that's used to do the sort of validation or used to do the analysis is often derived or is necessarily derived from a much richer data set where there's probably something like charges. Like that data exists when somebody's arrested, like the charges, right? And so—
Sure, but it seems to have been obscured in most cases.
Yeah, but usually when the analysis takes place, it is a zero or one, like you said, the sort of binary, yes, it happened. No, it didn't happen. Now, one good thing about the Arnold tool is that it does break out the failure to appear, the rearrest for anything, and rearrest for violent. In some things I've seen, those are sort of conflated. It's just this sort of, it's usually called like a joint, not joint, I forget the word. I'm staying home too much. I'm getting dull. But it's sort of like this aggregate thing. Did any of these things happen, right? This or this or this is predicted. Yeah, but certainly it's all derived from much, much richer data where you could do things that were much more high resolution, I guess, or more specific.